most common limit switch assembly consists of four rotors which are geared to the actuator drive shaft. Each rotor has four cam lobes that are used to operate electrical switches. When the cam rotates horizontal, it depresses the plunger of the switch, closing the contact. The setting rod in the center of the assembly is used for decoupling the rotor from the main drive gear. The intermediate shafts are used for manually advancing or rewinding the timing when the setting rod is disengaged. These contacts are used for keeping track of the valve position and are very critical for the overall operation of the MOV. Before we begin setting the limits, we should first locate the electrical schematic for the specific valve you are working on. The electrical drawing will contain a depiction of the limit switch timing, referred to as a tumbler map. The thicker black line is used to represent a closed contact state. For example, contact number 5 is used to bypass the torque switch, which allows the valve to use full opening force when coming off of the valve seat. This contact should only be closed when the valve is at full closed position and opens immediately after the valve breaks off the seat. I will now demonstrate how to adjust the timing to match this tumbler map. Start by engaging the clutch and crank the valve to the full open position using the hand wheel. While opening the valve, note which direction the intermediate shaft is rotating. Once you reach the mechanical stop, reverse the wheel and crank the valve closed one revolution. This position will be used for the open rotor trip point. From this valve position, take note of the orientation of the cams associated with the contacts labeled open. In this case, contacts 1 and 2 are open. If we look at the map, these contacts should be closed at this point, so we know that we must advance the timing. Now, if you recall, the shafts were rotating counterclockwise while opening. For a visual aid, this graphic represents the current state of the cam. From this illustration, we can see that if we want to reach the trip point, we must rotate the cam in the same direction it was rotating while it was opening. We will begin making adjustments by first disengaging the gear. This is done by depressing and rotating the setting rod. Now that the gear is disengaged, the intermediate shaft is free to rotate, but it is important that we do not spin the gears faster than 200 RPM. Since this rotor needs to be advanced, I will spin it the same direction it was rotating while opening. Continue adjusting the rotor until the exact trip point is found. Once this is done, re-engage the setting rod by rotating a quarter turn until it fully extends. To ensure the teeth of the gear are fully engaged, attempt to rotate the intermediate shafts. The shafts should not move once the setting rod is engaged. Crank the valve to the fully closed position, taking note the direction the shafts are rotating while closing. Once the mechanical stop is reached, reverse the wheel, pulling the plug out of the seat slightly. If this valve is set for torque seating, you can back the wheel off 1.5 turns. However, if the valve is designed to close on position, then only back the wheel 1/2 turn. If you are unsure if the valve is torque seating or not, look for a jumper on the actuator that effectively bypasses contact number 8. From this valve position, contacts 5 and 6 should be closed. And in this case, contacts 5 and 6 are closed. But since we don't know when it tripped, we should rewind the timing to ensure the trip point falls at this specific point in travel. This visual aid shows the state of contact 5. The shaft was rotating clockwise while the valve was closing. The contact is closed, but the contact closed prior to reaching this point. So as you can see, we must rotate the shaft in the opposite direction it was rotating while closing. As before, we must start by disengaging the gear using the setting rod. We will continue rewinding the rotor until we find the trip point, making sure to leave contact 5 and 6 in the closed position. Return the setting rod to the engaged position. To ensure the teeth of the gear are fully engaged, attempt to rotate the intermediate shafts. The shafts should not move once the setting rod is engaged. This should be done every time you re-engage the setting rod. Since this valve only uses the open and closed limit switch rotors, we are done setting the limits and we can begin testing the MOV operation. For this valve, the red light should be illuminated at fully closed position. When we open the valve, the green light should immediately turn on and both lights remain illuminated during mid-travel. Once the valve reaches the upper limit, the red light should turn off and the valve should stop moving. When you hand crank the valve open, you should find that the valve stopped traveling very close to the upper mechanical stop. If not, you may need to adjust the upper limit. When we close the valve, the red light should turn on and both lights should remain on until the valve reaches the closed limit. Since this valve closes on torque, we will find that the green light should turn off just prior to the valve shutting off. When making adjustments to the timing, it is important that you ensure you have selected the correct direction for adjustment. If we go back to the position we were in on the closed limit switch, we can see that the switch had already tripped, and we had to rewind the timing to ensure the trip point was accurate. However, if we had chosen to turn the gear the wrong direction, we would have eventually reached the opposite trip point. It is important to remember the following. When you are at the open limit, if contacts 1 and 2 are not closed, turn the shaft the same direction it was rotating while opening. If they are closed, turn the shaft the opposite direction. And when at the closed limit, if contacts 5 and 6 are not closed yet, turn the shaft the same direction it was rotating while closing. And if they are closed already, then turn the shaft the opposite direction.